uterine fibroid embolization, technical aspects, assessing the departmental provision of uterine fibroid embolization, King's College Hospital, August 2008 to October 2014. Background: uterine fibroids are benign tumors of the uterus. Whilst most are asymptomatic, they may cause menorrhagia, abdominal discomfort, urinary symptoms, and occasionally infertility. For many years, the mainstay of treatment was surgical myomectomy. However, since 1995, interventional radiologists have been treating symptomatic fibroids by embolizing arterial tumor supply, most commonly using PVA particles. As a minimally invasive procedure, this confers the advantage of a decreased length of hospital stay. UFE has been the subject of randomized controlled trials and a Cochrane review. NICE recommends that fibroid embolization is provided in the context of regular audit. Results. Standard pre-procedural MRI should be performed in questionably 100% of cases. Our result was 96% of cases. The surgical safety checklist should always be completed in 100% of cases, and technical success is expected in more than 90% of cases achieved with a rate of 100. Screening time should be less than 90 minutes, with a target of 80% achieved at a rate of 100%. The DAP should be less than 450 in more than 80% of cases achieved in 93% of cases. The length of stay should be less than 24 hours in more than 50% of cases achieved in 76%. The complication rates are various depending on the type of complication. 0% of complications in the 50 cases. Follow-up in more than 90% of cases. This is currently unclear. Further information at this links. Pre-procedural MRI wasn't always indicated, as one patient had a previous laparotomy and unsuccessful hysterectomy due to bowel adhesions, and one patient had metallic stents which were contraindicated for MRI. Technical success: various reporting styles not routinely report technical success or failure, and was presumed success unless otherwise stated. Screening time and DAP. Screening time in minutes, mean 31 with a range of 15 to 62, and DAP mean of 156 and a range of 11 to 657. Length of stay: 4 patients stayed up to 48 hours, 1 due to pain, 1 due to delayed passage of urine, and 1 where there was puncture site concern by the clinical team, but this proved to be self-limiting, and 1 patient stayed for 4 days due to pain and fever, which settled with antibiotics. Complications: fever prior to discharge in one case, pain and A&E attendance on day 4 in one patient which was self-limiting and no intervention was needed. There was a puncture site hematoma and A&E attendance on day 2 in one case which was self-limiting and did not require intervention. The recognized complications of the procedure are hematoma, thrombosis, dissection, pseudoaneurysm in less than 5% of cases, pseudoembolization syndrome requiring readmission in less than 5%, vaginal discharge in less than 16%, fibroid expulsion in less than 10%, endometritis in less than 5%, amenorrhea in less than 7% at 1 year, and less than 1% rate of hysterectomy. Follow-up, discharge summaries. From January to October 2014, looking at 5 cases, gynecology outpatients in 3 months, blank, gynecology outpatients in 8 weeks, MRI in 6 months times 2. Patients are rebooked automatically for MRI follow-up now. Clinical follow-up is variable. Patients are re-referred by GP or self-referred. Treatment success is unclear in the long term in particular. So, recommendation: there is the option of adopting the Royal Society of North America UFE reporting template or using a local template. And that could include specifying routine follow-up in the report and an ONG follow-up appointment. So the meeting outcome that we've planned was to include the above and reordered once ONG follow-up has been confirmed, which would be in several years' time. And here are the references.